prayer and praise services we'll be having over this summer. And I hope you'll be blessed by your presence here as much as we have been blessed in preparing for the service this night. The service is a very blended service, so you are going to hear some traditional, you're going to hear a little contemporary, and you're going to hear a little bit of the middle of the road. And so some of this music may be new to you, and what I would invite you to do is just really kind of listen. The words will be in your bulletin or in the hymnal, or sing along as you are able. We've got a great choir and ensemble over there that is wonderful at leading worship, so hope you'll sing as you are able, or just worship with it. As you learn the music. There'll be some spoken responses prior to the hymns, but no worries. We will lead you into when you are supposed to be singing. On page 4, you will notice some bidding prayers. That is part of what we're doing here tonight. It is a prayer and praise service. So we are going to spend some time in conversation with God, praying for specific things. And you will note that there is a refrain that is sung following Pastor Johnson's leadership of the bidding prayer response. And again, we will lead you through that. Feel free to sing. Lord, listen to your children praying as we get into that area. We are also offering communion because you know our motto around here, when we meet, we?
Yes.
Of course we do. Yes, we do. And so we will be inviting you. I don't know that we have any ushers. We will be coming up, and so this side will come over, and we'll start there, and we'll fill in the altar this way, and receive communion at what we call single serve, as opposed to like a Sunday morning where you double up in the aisle here. So come on up and start over there, and we will be serving you communion. The last thing that I would mention is we do get to do this again. It is in your bulletin there, but we will be doing this again, and we will be gathering on July 18th. And also August 8th. So I hope you will be blessed enough that you will even come back for those services and invite some friends or family to that service. All right, any other announcements? Go to the community. Let's find out who it is we're worshiping with. Please rise and greet one another.
Let us pray. O Lord, our Creator and Redeemer, as we come together to worship you in spirit and in truth, we humbly pray that you would open our hearts to the preaching of your word, spoken and sung this night. For your word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. May we embrace and ever hold fast to the blessed hope of eternal life we have received through your living word, Jesus Christ, the Lord and Savior, and in whose name we pray. Amen.
Please rise as we prepare to sing our opening hymn, our first opening hymn, in the red hymnal number 530. But first, a reading from Psalm 25. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. In you I trust, O my God. Guide me in your truth and teach me, for you are God, my Savior, and my hope is in you all day long. I love you, O Lord, my strength. The Lord is my rock, my fortress, and my deliverer. He is my shield and the horn of my salvation, my stronghold. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy of praise, and I am saved from my enemies.
Oh,
Draw us to the life-giving stream where we will never thirst again. You alone are our strength and our shield, neighbor and claimer.
Lesson.
is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 10. Moses writes that the man who practices the righteousness which is based on the law shall live by it. But the righteousness based on faith says, do not say in your heart, who will ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down. Or who will descend into the abyss? That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what does it say? The word is near you, on your lips and in your heart. That is the word of faith which we preach. Because if you confess with your lips that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For man believes with his heart and is so justified, and he confesses with his lips and is so saved. The scripture says, no one who believes in him will be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek. The same Lord is Lord of all, and bestows his riches upon all who call upon him. For everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. But how are men to call upon him whom they have not believed? And how are they to believe in him of whom they have never heard? How are they to hear without preaching? And how can men preach unless they are sent? As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who preach the good news. But they have not obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah says, Lord, who has believed what he has heard from us? So faith comes from what is heard, and what is heard comes from the preaching of Christ. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I understand more than the ages, for I keep my precepts.
chapter. Jesus said, "Everyone then who hears these words of mine and does them will be like the wise man who built his house upon the rock. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat upon the house, but it did not fall, because it had been founded upon the rock. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. And the rain fell, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat against that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." And when Jesus finished saying these things, the crowds were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as their scribes. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for this time we have tonight to worship you, for your word at work in our lives, for the Spirit drawing us here. So we pray now that you would open our ears to hear all that is that you desire us to hear this night, and then by the power of your Holy Spirit, as we leave here, give us strength to do it. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. So yeah, it is kind of a little good to be here tonight, to gather as a community, as the people of God, and to maybe exercise our spiritual muscles. We gather in corporate worship, whether it be on a Wednesday night, a Saturday night, or a Sunday morning. And we know, of course, though, that our worship doesn't begin and end with this worship setting. Our lives and the way we live them is our spiritual worship, where those spiritual muscles really get a workout, and our faith at times will even get tested. It's where faith and life become a testimony and a witness to God's word at work in each one of us. "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." This is the theme we will be using over these three prayer and praise services this summer. Now, you hear us pastors talk an awful lot about the importance of the Word, being in it, hearing it, reading it, saying it, praying it, just doing it all about the Word. And just so we're clear, when I say the Word, I do mean the Bible and Scripture. I'm talking about Genesis to Revelation. The Word is where God's nature is revealed and our nature is exposed. And our relationship with the Father is nurtured, because we know also that faith comes by hearing the Word, of course. I don't recall when it was, other than it was a really long time ago, but I do remember the sheer panic I felt when I first heard this phrase: "Christianity is one generation away from extinction." Now, granted, I was young of age and faith, and it took some real spirit work to resolve this very disturbing idea planted in my brain. How could this God that I know and read about in the Bible allow something so catastrophic to happen? What would happen to the meaning of Jesus on the cross? Why would I even need a Savior if sin didn't exist, or if it didn't even matter? What about all those Sunday school lessons I sat through, or confirmation class lessons I sat through? Was this faith that had named and claimed me now in vain? I mean, can you tell I was just a little tormented by this? So what did I do? I went to Word. Yes, even at a young age, I realized that maybe God had something to say about this, and oh, what joy and peace I found when I got into that Word. What I read in the Scriptures was that God was genuinely concerned, genuinely loved all that he had created, so much so that he will actually send his only Son to die for us, but on the third day he's going to rise. See, since the foundation of the time, God has had this plan to get the message into the ears and hearts of those who have not yet heard. It is his desire that all should come to know him and confess him as Lord. But how will they know him if they have not heard? How will the Word have any power or authority in their lives if it's not preached or taught to them? Now, I know in the end, What they were really saying wasn't what I had taken it for. But it was really about, you know, there is a harvest out there, and God's really serious about it. There are people out there building homes on sandy lots, and their foundation will fall and sink, as that gospel lesson says today. They will put their trust in rulers of this world or in themselves, because they don't yet know, they have not yet heard about the life-giving power of the Word. We gather here tonight because somewhere, somehow, we have heard. Thanks be to God. By His grace and mercy, beautiful feet, as the Roman text says, they have made their way to us and opened to us the Scriptures, opened to us the good news of Jesus Christ. And it is in our hearing this good news that we gather tonight to give Him praise and thanks for all that He has done, all that He is doing, and all that He has yet to do in our lives. We believe, even though we might wrestle with it from time to time, that God's Word has power and authority in our lives. He has the words of eternal life. His Word gives us hope, gives us guidance. It gives us purpose for everyday life, even while we wait for the next one. Otherwise, I have no idea what we're even doing here tonight, right? I was driving the other day, and no, this is not a Bay Meadows Road story, I promise, but I did come upon this intersection, and as I was approaching the intersection, the light turned yellow. Now, I know what some of y'all are thinking. Yellow means speed up! And, of course, other of you are thinking that yellow means slow down and stop. Now, I admit, I vacillated between the two perspectives, but at this particular moment, I went with a slow down and stop approach. Another driver in another lane well behind me went with the other perspective and sped up. And he literally ran a red light at full speed, if not fuller, because I know he probably gunned it. And thanks be God, there were no New York drivers around, because we know from our New York driver here that green means go and go now. Hurry up already, you know, because it would not have been a pretty sight. So as I patiently waited at that red light, I thought about our theme for tonight. I had just a little bit of time. How does the authority and power of Thy Word yet reflected in our lives? How is it lived out? What difference does God's Word make in our everyday life? I looked at that red light. Now I know, we know the laws of the land, right? That red light does have authority, okay? Not the actual light, but the meaning of the light has authority. Stop means stop. It's not a suggestion, it's there for a reason. But in some ways, it doesn't have any authority until someone sees it. And obeys it. That's when it receives its power, when there is a response to what is signifying. Now, isn't that kind of our challenge when it comes to hearing the Word of God? We continually butt up against what the world says versus what the Word says. We vacillate between earthly kingdoms and heavenly kingdoms. It isn't as though Jesus didn't warn us about this. I mean, even when he taught his disciples, he would start some of those teachings with, "You've heard it said this, but I say to you this." We continually struggle, as Paul would say, in doing or not doing what we know to be right. And then we do the things that we know aren't right. That authority and power of the Word has us recognizing that we do indeed fall short from responding to what God calls us to do. Yet, it doesn't end there. Thanks be to God. Do we not think God can see our struggles? I mean, He was there in the garden. He was there for the golden calf. He was there at the Last Supper as Jesus took the disciples' dirty feet and washed them clean, even knowing they would betray him. He was there when they pounded the nails into Jesus' hands and feet. He was there as the disciples gathered in the upper room behind the closed doors because they were in fear. And he's here even now, knowing all the details of your life, even the ones you aren't able to speak about. And his word says, "Come to me, all who are weary, and I will give you rest." I get tired, frustrated, confused, uncertain about what's next. I've got you. I love you. I forgive you, and I will not let you go. Believe in me and live. We can rest in the word, being rest assured of God's faithfulness. For he is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. The power of the word at work in our lives is when we trust and believe, even at times we don't understand, that God is faithful because his word is faithful. What he has spoken, what he has written, he will do. And that's some mighty good news for us. And the good news that he now places on our heart to get out of here and to share with others, to go and be his disciples, to preach and teach to the captives, to set the prisoners free and declare the mighty acts of our Father. Christ taught with authority because he was the living word. And now, just as he said, power from on high will call us together. He will gather us together, and that power will be unleashed in each one of us. And it is by that power he sends us out of here to go and be pretty feet to other people. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I pray that we would never grow weary of hearing or reading God's word, so that we might be strengthened in faith this and every day. And I pray the word would never lose its power or authority in our lives, so that we might have those beautiful feet as well out there in the world, teaching and preaching, telling the story of things seen and unseen, and sharing the good news of Jesus Christ in word and deed. I pray that for you and for me, in Jesus' name. Amen. Take a few moments to meditate on the word and the will of God. Please rise for our hymn of the evening, which is found in your red hymnal, number 409.
We confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed found on page 3. I believe in God, the Father Almighty,
Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified by Caius Caesar. He ascended into heaven. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of life, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated or kneel as you are able to forgive you. Holy Church of God throughout the world, that God the Almighty Father guide it and gather it together, so that we may worship Him in peace and tranquility. May He inspire all those who lead and serve, so that they may know His guidance and direction, and may He enlighten us through His Word to know and do His will in the world. Almighty and eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. Guide the work of the Church. Help it to persevere in faith, proclaim your name, and bring salvation to people everywhere. Strengthen and uphold all servants of your Church. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the Church, and help each of us to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. Lord, in your compassion and mercy, hear our prayer.
Exposing that which is not pleasing in His eyes, guiding us by the power of His Word, and leading us to the power of His Holy Spirit to do and say only that which is pleasing to Him.
Almighty and merciful Father, we kneel humbly before you, filled with awe at your grace and compassion. In your mercy, you sent your dear Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, to deal with sin, the devil, and death itself, so that we might live in a renewed and right relationship with you. Grant us true confession. Dead to sin, we may be raised up by your life-giving absolution. Grant us your Holy Spirit, that we may ever be watchful and live true and godly lives in your service. Lord, in your compassion and mercy, hear our prayers.
Thank you.
times to serve our neighbor, reflect his love and care, and glorify him.
Gracious and abundant Lord, you have blessed us beyond what we deserve. You give us all that we have and all that we are, signs of your gracious love for us. Help us to be content and trust you when things feel scarce, and inspire us to be generous when things are abundant. Lord, in your compassion and mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, with compassion you hear the cries of your people in great distress. Be with all who now endure affliction. Bless the work of those who bring relief, including missionaries, first responders, and those who serve on our behalf. Protect them in their service and enable their work to aid and comfort those who are suffering, that they may find renewed hope and purpose. Lord, in your compassion and mercy, hear our prayers. eternal God. You give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Grant us grace at all times to cast our cares and concerns on you. For in our weakness, you make us strong. In our sorrow, struggles, and strife, you bring comfort, peace, and hope. You, Lord, are the great physician, the good shepherd. Mercifully renew us in faith and hope this day and all our days. Watch over those who are near and dear to us. We pray for you, Linda, and pray you would watch over her in her back this evening. We pray for David and Lynn, for Jean and Bria, for Mark struggling with his cancer, and all others we pray before you now, either silently in our hearts or aloud on our lips.
And the peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Then after supper he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Please be seated.
Thank you.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and